Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the action potential in neurons, and in part two, we're going to see what happens during one action potential. Action potentials are how excitable cells like nerve and muscle cells transmit signals. They are brief changes in the membrane potential. The change happens with the voltage-gated sodium channels and the voltage-gated potassium channels. Let's have a quick recap of some of the basics we went over in part one. The voltage-gated sodium channels move between three states: closed when the activation gate is closed but the inactivation gate is open, ions can't pass through in this state. Open is when the activation gate opens, now ions can pass through. And when the inactivation gate closes, that's when the channels become inactivated. Ions can't pass through again, and after a short duration, they come back to the closed state again. Only channels from the closed state can be opened, so the inactivated channels have to come back to the closed state before they can open again. The voltage-gated potassium channel just has one gate that opens and closes. At rest, the membrane potential is negative and the membrane is polarized. Sodium entering the cell makes the membrane potential more positive and causes depolarization. When that stops and potassium leaves the cell, the membrane potential starts becoming more negative again. That's repolarization. Continued potassium efflux makes the membrane potential more negative than at rest. That is hyperpolarization. Now let's see how these phases of an action potential happen. We're going to be looking at the action potential in neurons, so we'll use this schematic neuron. It has dendrites, a cell body, the axon hillock, the initial segment, which is the first part of the axon, and the axon ends in synaptic terminals. I've just drawn one synaptic terminal to represent them since it's schematic, and these terminals, they've got synaptic vesicles. The action potential usually starts at the initial segment of the axon, and I'll explain why that is in a bit. We start at rest. At rest, the membrane is at resting membrane potential, the RMP, which is around negative 70 millivolts for most neurons. This potential is going to change and come back to the RMP again. At rest, the membrane is more permeable to potassium than sodium. What starts the process is a stimulus. This has to be an excitatory stimulus, meaning it has to cause depolarization. Why? Because for an action potential to happen, the membrane potential has to reach a threshold. That's a minimum potential at which the action potential can start. This could be between negative 50 and negative 55 millivolts. Different books give different numbers. Sometimes I've just picked easy ones to be able to explain it. To go from negative 70 to negative 55, the membrane potential has to become more positive. That's by entry of cations like sodium. So from the stimulus, there has to be sodium entry, like, for example, an excitatory neurotransmitter from a presynaptic neuron. The neurotransmitter released from the presynaptic neuron, that'll bind to its receptor on the postsynaptic membrane. It opens ligand-gated channels that let sodium ions enter the cell. This is just one example. It could be any stimulus, receptor potentials, other neurotransmitters, etc. Point is, we need a stimulus, and the stimulus should start depolarizing the membrane. These are graded potentials. This stimulus is changing the membrane potential, yes, but it's not an action potential. We haven't gotten to that yet. Remember, we have to reach a threshold for that to happen. If the stimulus is not strong enough to get it to threshold, they will decay. These are sub-threshold stimuli, and they are graded potentials, which I'll hopefully talk about in another video. But right now, what we need is the threshold, and if the stimulus does manage to make that happen, there will be an action potential, and it will be to the full extent that that cell is capable of. Even if it's a stronger stimulus than the threshold stimulus, it'll still be to the same extent. But if it doesn't get to threshold, there will be no action potential. This is the all-or-none phenomenon, everything or nothing. I'm going to draw a rectangle to represent the initial segment of the axon. So at threshold, what happens? That potential opens the voltage-gated sodium channels. First, let's put down the membrane potential. Remember the activation and inactivation gates? The activation gate opens, and now sodium ions rush in. The membrane now is more permeable to sodium than potassium, so it's getting depolarized. The potential is becoming less negative and more positive. That's the upstroke. The opening of the sodium channel sets up a positive feedback cycle. More channels are opening, more sodium is entering, more depolarization, so more channels open. In large nerves, it can cross zero and actually become positive. This is called the overshoot. So sodium ions are trying to bring the membrane potential close to their equilibrium potential, which is around positive 60 millivolts. Trying to, but they're not completely successful because the potential that opens the activation gate closes the inactivation gate. There's just a slight delay that's enough for these sodium ions to enter and cause depolarization. So when the sodium channels start inactivating, the potential starts falling. And now we'll bring in the voltage-gated potassium channels. As the membrane depolarized from negative 70 towards zero, the potassium channels open as well. But they are slow. They are not as fast as those sodium channels. So by the time they open, the sodium channels are inactivating. How does potassium move? It leaves the cell, trying to bring the membrane potential close to its equilibrium potential, which is around negative 90 millivolts. So the membrane potential is becoming more negative again. This is the downstroke, repolarization. Now the membrane is more permeable to potassium than sodium. The downstroke reaches rest, but then goes below that. The curve becomes more negative than rest. That's because the potassium channels are slow to close. Potassium continues leaving, making the membrane potential more negative. They're still trying to get close to potassium's equilibrium potential. This undershoot is called hyperpolarization, also called the after potential. Once the gates close, the ions can't pass through this channel anymore, and we come back up to the resting membrane potential again. So the curve comes back up to RMP. That is one action potential. This action potential usually starts at the initial segment because that's where there is the highest density of voltage-gated sodium channels. And once the action potential is generated, it has to get propagated. And that's what we're going to see in part 3. If this video helps you, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.